The Jordan River has been a source of fascination for centuries, drawing pilgrims and explorers to its banks in search of spiritual and historical insights. But the discoveries made in recent years have surpassed even the wildest dreams of those who have come before, and well, it's happened again.
A pleasure resource, a little bit of heaven on earth.
Join us as we dig deeper into the terrifying discovery that's been made in the dried up Jordan River and how it might change everything we've ever known about the area. Jordan is a land of contrasts, where ancient history meets modern innovation. And that's not just something of today, it's always been the case. No matter where you look, there's something that would leave you speechless. One of the biggest discoveries to date has been that of Petra. It's a city carved into the red sandstone cliffs of Jordan over 2,000 years ago by the Nabataeans, and it's a sight you won't forget. The entrance to Petra is through the narrow canyon known as the Sick, which feels like you're walking through a magical tunnel. Suddenly, the rock walls part, and you see the treasury. The most famous building in Petra. It's a massive, intricately carved structure that was once believed to hold hidden treasure. Although it's just a mausoleum now, it's still one of the most impressive things you'll ever see. But the treasury is just the beginning. Petra was once a thriving hub of trade and commerce, and it shows in how the entire place is carved. It's no average handiwork. Years and years of work went into it to make it what it is. Plus, it had to be made that way for it to have survived all these centuries. There's the Great Temple, which was dedicated to the Nabataean gods and was a place of religious ceremonies and rituals. The monastery, located high up on a mountain, is a massive structure with stunning views. It was probably a temple, but little remains of it today. There's also the royal tombs, which were carved into the rock for the Nabataean elite. The tombs are decorated with intricate carvings, and they're a testament to the skill and artistry of the craftsmen of the era. The most impressive of these tombs is the urn tomb, which features a massive urn-shaped structure carved into the rock. But despite all of that, one of the most fascinating things about Petra is its size. It covers an area of over 100 square miles, and it's believed to have had a population of around 30,000 people at its peak. That's a lot of people for a city carved into the side of a mountain. The Nabataeans were incredibly advanced for their time, with a complex system of water channels, cisterns, and dams that allowed them to thrive in harsh desert environments. Petra was lost to the outside world for centuries, but it was rediscovered in the early 19th century by Swiss explorer Johann Ludwig Burckhardt. Since then, it's become a popular destination for travelers and adventurers from all over the world. It's a UNESCO World Heritage Site and a symbol of Jordan's rich cultural heritage. One of the most important discoveries in Petra was the Nabataean Theater, which was discovered in the early 20th century. This massive structure could seat up to 4,000 people and was used for everything from religious ceremonies to theatrical performances. Another important discovery in Petra was the Petra Church, which was discovered in the 1990s. This early Christian church was built in the 5th century AD and was one of the largest and most impressive churches in the region. It's believed that the church was used by the Byzantine Empire, which controlled the region at the time. In addition to these structures, archaeologists have also discovered numerous artifacts in the area overall. These artifacts include pottery, jewelry, and coins, as well as tools and weapons. These artifacts provide insight into the daily life of the Nabataean people, but it wasn't just that. With these discoveries, it also became abundantly clear that there was a need to look into Jordan with a macro lens. That's where things got crazier. And also what brings us to the Jordan River. The Jordan River, a place that holds tremendous significance for millions of people around the world. This 156-mile-long river winds its way from the north to the south, passing through the Sea of Galilee and finally into the Dead Sea, the lowest point on Earth. Now, just very quick, if it's your first time here on my channel, I would appreciate if you would like the video so that you can help me to continue spreading Christian messages. Subscribe and also click that notification bell so you won't miss any of the next videos that are uploaded every day. All right, let's keep rolling. And it's not just the stunning natural beauty of the river that makes it so special. For Christians, the Jordan River is a site of immense religious importance, as it is believed to be the very spot where Jesus himself was baptized by John the Baptist. But the Jordan River's significance doesn't end there. Both the Old and New Testaments are filled with references to the Jordan River and the events that took place in its vicinity. In fact, the river was the site of several pivotal moments in the history of Christianity. For instance, it was where John the Baptist began his public ministry, and where countless others have been baptized over the centuries. According to Joshua chapter 3, verse 9 and 10, God commanded the Israelites to stand in the Jordan River when they reached its waters. Tell the priests who carry the Ark of the Covenant, when you reach the edge of Jordan's waters, go and stand in the river. Joshua said to the Israelites, "Come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God." With things like this, there are three categories people are divided into. There will be people that totally dismiss the entire idea, those that believe it at face value, and those who want to dig deeper. The combination of all three of these categories brings us more and more discoveries about the area every year. One of the biggest discoveries of the Jordan River area was the Dead Sea Scrolls. These ancient manuscripts, discovered between 1947 and 1956 in 11 caves near Kirbet Qumran on the northwestern shores of the Dead Sea, are approximately 2,000 years old, dating from the 3rd century BCE to the 1st century CE. But apart from being old, what makes them so special? For starters, the Dead Sea Scrolls represent the earliest evidence of the biblical text in the world. The majority of the scrolls were written in Hebrew, with a smaller number in Aramaic or Greek. Most of them were written on homemade parchment, with the exception of a few written on papyrus. Although the vast majority of the scrolls survived as fragments, scholars have managed to reconstruct from these fragments approximately 950 different manuscripts of various lengths. The manuscripts fall into three major categories: biblical, apocryphal, and sectarian. The biblical manuscripts comprise some 200 copies of books of the Hebrew Bible, including fragments of every book except Esther. Among the apocryphal manuscripts are works that had previously been known only in translation, or were completely new information that no one had seen or heard of before. The sectarian manuscripts reflect a wide variety of literary genres: biblical commentary, religious legal writings, liturgical texts, and apocalyptic compositions. Most scholars believe that the scrolls form the library of the sect that lived at Qumran, known as the Essenes. However, it appears that the members of this sect wrote only part of the scrolls themselves, and the remainder having been composed or copied elsewhere. The discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls represents a turning point in the study of the history of the Jewish people in ancient times, for never before has a literary treasure of such magnitude come to light. So to say that the scrolls are special would be an understatement, and so was their discovery. The first seven scrolls were discovered purely by chance. It happened in 1947 by Bedouin, who are indigenous people of the Negev Desert in southern Israel, in a cave near Kirbet Qumran on the northwest shore of the Dead Sea. Three of the scrolls were immediately purchased by archaeologist E.L. Sukenik on behalf of the Hebrew University. The others were bought by the Metropolitan of the Syrian Orthodox Church in East Jerusalem, Mar Athanasius Samuel. In 1948, Samuel smuggled the four scrolls in his possession to the United States. It was only in 1954 that Sukenik's son, Yigael Yadin, also an archaeologist, was able to bring them back. Over the next few years, from 1949 to 1956, additional fragments of some 950 different scrolls were discovered, both by Bedouins and by a joint archaeological expedition of the École Biblique et Archéologique Française and the Rockefeller Museum. It all happened under the direction of Professor Father Roland Deveau. Since then, no further scrolls have come to light, though excavations have been carried out from time to time at the site and nearby. But you see, just because there weren't any more scrolls doesn't mean that other discoveries haven't been made. Quite the opposite. Archaeologists may have actually discovered the first ever evidence of the biblical story of Exodus. The story of Exodus is spread over the biblical books of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. It begins with the Israelites enslaved in Egypt before the Pharaoh, coerced by 10 terrible plagues, agrees to release them, and Moses leads them across the miraculously parted Red Sea. Once they reached the Sinai Peninsula, Scripture says they traveled to Mount Sinai, where Moses received the Ten Commandments. They then headed to the southern border of Canaan, but being too scared to enter, were condemned to 38 years in the wilderness by God. After passing the years at the oasis of Kadesh Barnea, the Israelites then traveled to the eastern border of Canaan, where, according to the story, Moses died and was buried on Mount Nebo. The subsequent book of Joshua tells the story of Joshua, who takes over the leadership of the Israelites, leading them into the promised land across the River Jordan and conquering Jericho. While there's no historical evidence to support the account, experts are currently analyzing ancient ruins near the River Jordan that could be proof of any nomadic Israelite people crossing into the ancient land from outside. The site, named Kirbet El Mastara, is located just 5 miles north of Jericho and has been dated to the early Iron Age, which coincides with the traditional timeline associated with the Israelite arrival. So at least in terms of timing, this one checks out. Archaeologists have been examining whether the ruins are consistent with a newly arrived nomadic people. Pottery shards found on the site have been dated to the early Iron Age, and the ruins themselves, which have several low walls, are believed to be rudimentary stone fencing for animals, which is consistent with known nomadic practices. Dr. David Ben Shlomo, an archaeologist with Ariel University, and his American dig partner, Ralph Hawkins of Averett University, have a theory. According to them, this could explain why pottery shards were found outside of the stone walls rather than inside. They said, "The floors of the structures were virtually empty of finds, and thus we couldn't date them by conventional archaeological methods. So the structures might have housed animals rather than people who lived in tents around them." This one quote alone changes everything we would have normally thought about this area. Normally, when you look into old buildings and structures, you look at them as homes for people. But if they built elaborate housing for animals, things could have been at a much bigger scale than we might have ever thought before. It's not just that. The site's location and the harsh climatic conditions of the region make it more plausible that it was a nomadic settlement than a permanent one. The landscape is arid most of the time, and even in modern times, most of the population in the region are Bedouins. Additionally, temperatures in the area can easily reach a scorching 45 degrees Celsius. This means that living conditions in the area may have been challenging and uncomfortable, especially for people who were not used to such high temperatures. The annual rainfall is also as little as 1 centimeter, so the area is likely very dry and arid, with little water available for drinking or agriculture. Again, this would have made life in the area difficult for people who were not used to such conditions. The site is also isolated and shielded from view by surrounding hills. This could imply that a new population was settling in the area and was afraid of being discovered or attacked by other groups. It adds to the possibility that the people who settled in the area were nomadic and were looking for a new place to live, away from other settled communities. The fact that the site is shielded from view by surrounding hills could have made it an attractive location for a new settlement, as it would have been easier to defend against potential attackers. All of the theories are consistent with settlers being there, at least for a little while. Now, these discoveries might still seem like a bit of a stretch. But think about it. It only takes one theory to uncover massive mounds of information, just like what happened with the discovery of Petra. So things are no different here. That means that while there's a working theory, the researchers are going to need specifics so they can take a theory and turn it into proven facts. The archaeologists are currently working to confirm whether the site is as old as they suspect. They've sent soil samples from Kerbet El Mastara for analysis. Samples from beneath the walls will be tested for a buildup of electrons, which get trapped over the years and are only released by light radiation. They could reveal the age of the structure. Meanwhile, samples from between the walls will be tested for elevated levels of phosphorus, which would be consistent with animal dung in them. These two things alone will be extremely helpful in confirming how old the structure is. It doesn't stop there, though. The archaeologists are also planning to excavate nearby Uja El Foka to determine whether it might be linked to the Israelite settlement of the region. But that's not exactly easy to do, as the archaeologists have to look for cultural clues that the site was indeed Israelite. It's very difficult since many aspects of the material culture of different groups, those from east or west of the Jordan River, may be too similar or not indicative enough, said Dr. Ben Shlomo, who's the co-director of the Kerbet El Mastara excavation project. But by gathering the facts and testing the data they have, they can come that much closer to finding out if the story of Exodus was actually true or not. While this discovery is super interesting but still developing, it turns out humans might have existed in the area long before that. There is now evidence that suggests that 60,000 years ago, the banks of the Jordan River were full of life. Human creatures hunted large animals, including an extinct cattle species called aurochs in this area, which is an extinct species of wild cattle. Excavations at the outlet of the Nahal Mahanaim stream revealed bone remains that can prove this. But this wasn't just any hunting ground. According to a paper in the Journal of Archaeological Science, the Nahal Mahanaim site was actually a place where human creatures ambushed, killed, and butchered animals. But who exactly were they? Were they Neanderthals or modern humans, or perhaps hybrids or even an unknown species? The mystery of their identity remains unsolved, but one thing is certain. They were extensively hunting the aurochs. The sheer number of aurochs' bones at the site suggests that hunting these large beasts was a common occurrence. What's remarkable is how the hunters seem to have done it with a limited number of tools. Normally, lithic assemblages from this time period would contain a range of tools, including scrapers for preparing animal hides. But at Nahal Mahanaim, the tools were mainly pointed elements that we associate with spear tips and cutting tools, their version of knives. The evidence indicates that the site was used for short durations, perhaps only a week at a time, and that it was task-specific. The hunters came to butcher and process the carcasses of the animals they hunted. But how did they hunt such large beasts with nothing but simple tools at hand? The archaeologists were surprised to find that the lithic assemblage didn't indicate complex tool use, and only a small number of the tips had diagnostic impact fractures. This suggests that the hunters did not use their spears from a safe distance, but instead got up close and personal with their prey, risking injury or worse, death. The revelation totally challenges our assumptions about the sophistication of ancient hunting techniques. Humans weren't just hiding out and trying to get by. They were the predators, even though the animals they were hunting were far larger and scarier than they were. What's even crazier is that even this isn't the earliest sign of humans existing and actively living in this area. Fish teeth were recently found in the now dried up parts of the Jordan River. Some 780,000 years ago, prehistoric humans were found to have regularly gathered near the Jordan River in what is now northern Israel to cook and eat huge fish caught in the nearby Lake Hula. The researchers analyzed the remains of carp-like fish teeth found at the site, concluding that the fish were heated to a specific temperature using a slow cooking method, which melted the rest of the skeleton before they were eaten. So they knew exactly what they were doing. The study shows how important fish was for early hominins in their migration route from Africa to the Levant and beyond. The findings also showed the huge importance of fish in the life of prehistoric humans for their diet and economic stability. It also proved that the ancient Hula Lake held fish species that became extinct over time. If you start at this discovery and work your way up all the way to Petra, you can see how drastically the area improved over time. And the terrifying part is that if researchers and archaeologists weren't digging for more and more information over the years, chances are thousands of years of history would have just stayed lost. If all of that can just disappear, who's to say that there aren't bigger secrets hiding in different corners of the earth? What else do you think is out there? Let us know in the comments below. If you liked this video, please give it a thumbs up, and we'll see you next time.
If you enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up and share it with your friends so we can keep making them. For more videos like this, hit the subscribe button and remember to click on the notification bell. Also, be sure to check out our other videos as well. Thanks for watching.